Bluetooth connected.
Deep were the waters.
Good morning, everybody. I want to welcome you to our Sunday morning evangelistic service. I trust and pray that you had a wonderful night's rest and you are having a wonderful weekend. I'm very happy to be here with you this morning. I have decided not to use the jacket because it's hot. I've got the fans on me and it's feeling a little better than it did yesterday. We give God thanks and praise for that. I want to welcome this morning Sister Anne-Marie Florentville. I know you're at work, you're on your way to work, but you're faithful. We thank you for joining us. Sister Brenda Samuel, good morning. Sister Patsy Bernard, welcome, my dear sister. Good to have you on this beautiful Sunday morning. God bless you. Sister Florence Eugene Williams, my dear friend and sister from St. Lucia. We attended the SDA Academy together. We were young people at the Castries SDA Church back in the day. Welcome, my dear. Sister Thea Charles, Sister Camelia Arthur, welcome to all of you. We thank God for your presence with us today. And, you know, I was trying to get all the names, but as the music was playing, you know, I had to be doing this and that. So I'm hoping to get the rest of the names, some of the other names, at the end of the service. This morning, you know, I did write and say that I was going to preach over the sermon from yesterday, but once I viewed the tape, I realized that I got everything said before we lost power. We lost power yesterday, and I want to just make sure that we don't lose power today. I'm making sure that we are fully connected so that we don't lose power today. You know, I've got to remember to make sure everything is where it is supposed to be. I am very happy to be here with you this morning, and I pray that God is going to grant us a blessing. Before we go into the Word, we're going to have a word of prayer. But before we do that, I want to remind you that on Tuesday night at 8 o'clock, we will be here with Evangelism 101. We implore you to join us so that we can study the Word of God together. I always say, if you have a question, a spiritual question, a biblical question, a question about your salvation, anything that has to do with the Bible, feel free to reach out to us and let us know the question, and we will answer it publicly on Tuesday night. Okay? You can reach me at 347-675-8729. All right? 347-675-8729. That's the official number for One Accord Christian Service Movement. And I am the secretary. I got the phone, so I'll answer the phone. All right? And I will get the message, and we will ask God to give us the answer by going through His Word so that we can present it to you on a Tuesday night. Okay? And of course, we fully plan to be operating full force next Sabbath at 8 o'clock, when we plan to be streaming from Zoom, from Facebook, and from YouTube. I have a lot of YouTube viewers that are telling me they are not on Facebook, and so they cannot get the services. They have to wait until we are done and I get it uploaded to YouTube. Every service, to include this one, will be uploaded to YouTube immediately after we are done today. Once that is done, I will make sure it gets out to you. All right? So I pray that you will bear with us as we endure these growing pains. But God is with us, and we know that He is going to take us from where we are to higher heights in Christ Jesus. We just got to stay faithful and allow God to be our guide and stay. And by His power, by the power of His Spirit, we endeavor to do that. Okay? So those are the announcements. I want to lift up this morning in prayer a young man named Elijah. His mother, Sister Genobia, has been asking us to pray for him. He, as a young man under 10, has already endured either 7 or 8 brain surgeries. Boy, I tell you, we can't wait for Jesus to come and put an end to sickness. Satan has attacked this little boy with sickness even before the age of 10. But our God is faithful. He has been directing the doctors and he has been enabling them to fix what Satan messed up. And this young man will grow in grace and in a full understanding and knowledge of God, so that he can be a light in this dark world, so that he may be able to be a witness. He has a testimony already. So we are going to lift him up in prayer today, so that God will continue the recovery from the last operation, which I think was on Thursday or Friday. All right? His mom said he was getting up every 15, 20 minutes because he was in so much pain, although he was heavily medicated. So we're going to ask God to alleviate the pain and hasten the recovery of his little boy, so that he can live the life that Jesus intended for him to live. All right? So, brethren, we are not going to waste any more time. We are going to delve into God's Word and allow His Spirit to speak to us. I must apologize. As I play the music, I don't know, it keeps stopping. I'm going to research it and find out why, so that we can rectify that problem. All right? So may God be with us as we endeavor to serve Him through songs of praise and the spoken word, and through prayer and supplication for each other. Let us bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, we thank you. We thank you for taking us safely through another night and bringing us to a brand new day. We thank you, Lord, for starting us on our way in a brand new week. We ask you, Lord, as we venture out this week, that you will go before us to guide us and direct us, that you will stand beside us to comfort and keep us, and that you will come up behind us to protect us. I say, Lord, that we are not deserving of your love, your mercy, your grace, your deliverance, your protection. But Lord, you who love us with an everlasting love, continue to provide these things for us. So we take a little time to say thank you, Lord. Thank you for your goodness towards us, in spite of our apostasy, our sin, our iniquity. You still love us, and you still reach out to us in love, seeking our hearts. May we submit and surrender our hearts to you and allow you to direct our steps. May we look at the life of your Son, Jesus Christ, and emulate it. May we imitate it. May we follow it, so that we may be like him, Lord. So when you look at us, you don't see us, but you see a reflection, a perfect reflection of your Son, Jesus Christ. Lord, at this time, we pray for all those who have situations that are adverse, whatever it may be. I pray, Lord, that you will come by them and that you will bless them, you will touch them, you will provide for them, you will enable them. I pray, Lord, that you will be in a marked and special way with little Elijah, Sister Genobia's son. She's a faithful daughter of yours. She studies your word and she understands your power. So, Lord, we join together in unity to call upon you to release your power on her little boy, your power of healing. May young Elijah abide under the shadow of the Almighty. May young Elijah abide under the Son of Righteousness. Yes, the one that comes with healing in his wings. May little old Elijah begin to receive the healing emanating from you into his head and the rest of his body, alleviating the pain and restoring him to perfect health and strength, so that he may grow to get to know you, love you, accept you, and serve you, and be a witness unto others. Lord, you have blessed him even at... I'm going to resume the broadcast. I don't know why the broadcast was paused. Sister Ann James, Sister Aline Jack, welcome. Welcome, Sister Hermina Miro, welcome. Welcome to you all, my dear brethren. God bless you and keep you all. All right. So, brethren, today the topic is entitled, I Ain't Going to Hell for Nobody. I Ain't Going to Hell for Nobody. And that is supposed to be each and every one of our desires. All right? The Bible tells us in Mark chapter 5 There's a story here of a man who lived among the tombs. The Bible says, and they came over unto the side of the sea into the country of the Gadarenes. And when he was come out of the ship, immediately there met him, him being Jesus, out of the tombs, a man with an unclean spirit, who had his dwellings among the tombs. And no man could bind him, no, not with chains, but that he had been off bound with fetters and chains. And the chains had been plucked asunder by him, and the fetters broken into pieces. Neither could any man tame him. And always, night and day, he was in the mountains and in the tombs, crying and cutting himself with stones. But when he saw Jesus afar off, my Bible says, he ran and worshipped him and cried with a loud voice and said, what have I to do with thee, Jesus, thou Son of the Most High God? I adjure thee by God that thou torment me not. For he said unto him, come out of the man, thou unclean spirit. And he asked him, Jesus asked the man, what is thy name? And he answered, saying, my name is Legion, for we are many. My name is Legion, for we are many. And it continues, and he besought him much that he would not send them away out of the country. Now there was nigh there unto the mountains a great herd of swine feeding, and all the devils besought him, saying, send us into the swine, that we may enter into them. And forthwith Jesus gave them leave, and the unclean spirits went out and entered into the swine, and the herd ran down a steep place into the sea. There were about 2,000, and were choked in the sea. And they that fed the swine fled and told it in the city and in the country. And they went out to see what it was that was done. And they come to Jesus and see him that was possessed with the devil and had the legion, sitting and clothed with in his right mind, and they were afraid. When he was raging, when he was a lunatic, when he was cutting himself, when he was crying out, when he was shouting, when he was in total control by 6,000 demons, they weren't afraid. But once he was clothed in his right mind, they were afraid. Ah, not everybody wants your deliverance. Not everybody is happy when Jesus saves you. Remember that. And they that saw it told them how it befell him that was possessed with the devil, and also concerning the swine. And when he was come into the ship, he that was possessed, we read in verse 18, all right? I didn't read verse 17. Let's leave verse 17 out. Verse 18. And when he was come into the ship, he that was possessed with the devil prayed him that he might be with him. The demon-possessed man who was delivered says to Jesus, I want to come with you. Howbeit Jesus suffered him not, but saith unto him, go home to thy friends and tell them how great things the Lord hath done for thee, and hath compassion on thee. Brethren, I just read you a story of a man who was possessed with 6,000 demons. How do I know that? The Bible tells me in Mark chapter 5, verse 8, Jesus said, come out of him, to the unclean spirit. Then Jesus asked in verse 9, what is thy name? And he answered and said, my name is Legion, L-E-G-I-O-N, for we are many. Okay, I did some research, and you can do some too. Google the term legion, and you will realize that in those days, a legion of soldiers in the Roman army, because the Romans ruled the world, was about 6,000 men. A legion of soldiers in the Roman army was made up of 6,000 men. So, my Bible tells me that one man was held down, was held captive, was in the control of 6,000 demons. You're talking about multiple personalities. Let me tell you. He crying 1 second and he laughing the next. 1 minute he vexed, the next minute he happy. Listen, demons galore. I need you to understand that Satan don't care. He will possess you with a legion of demon angels to ensure your eternal damnation. We've got to understand how the enemy operates so we can fight the battle the way Jesus did, so we can be victorious. Because we don't want to go to hell for anybody. Jesus comes on the beach, and as he comes out of the boat, a raving maniac comes running down the beach. When the disciples see that thing, because he was neither human nor beast, he was a conglomeration of all, because he was recreated in the image and the likeness of his father, the devil. He was possessed. And so as he came, I could see the disciples running back into the ship. But Jesus stood his ground, like he expects us to do today. When we are faced with the enemy, we have to stand like a brave with our faces to the foe. And yes, he has promised to be with us, to never leave us nor forsake us. We've got to remember that. So Jesus stands his ground. And the man comes and falls on his face, and he worships Christ. And then the demons begin to speak. Now, it is not written in the Bible, but the assumption of some religious scholars, some biblical scholars, is that the man figured out who the man that he was running to was, because he heard the demons saying to each other, "Here comes the Son of God. Here comes Jesus of Nazareth. Here comes our Creator. Here comes the Redeemer of the world." And that man who was in bondage and needed redemption decided it was his opportunity. So he started to run to Jesus. Brethren, we live in a world today where people run away from everything spiritual. People run away from everything that has to do with Jesus Christ of Nazareth. But we want the blessings and the abundant life that the Jesus we're running away from came to provide. And I call on us to take a closer look at what we do, how we do it, and who influences us. Because we don't want to go to hell for anybody. That man who was living in hell, he was a dead man. He had been living among the tombs. Nobody in society regarded him. Nobody. If you saw him, you'd cross the street, hold your nose and turn your head, because you were walking by the dead. But Jesus crossed the sea, braved the storm to go get that man. And on that beachfront that morning, brethren, I'm here to let you know that Satan and his demon angels were arrayed on the right side, on the left side. And Jesus, the Son of God, and his angels were arrayed on the right side. And there was a man in the middle, and both sides wanted him. Do you understand who you are? Do you understand? understand the love that God has for you, the length through which he would go to save you, to get you, to deliver you, to protect you, to bless you, to keep you? Do you understand, brethren? Do you understand? I understand, because I was that man. I was that man. A vagrant, a bum, a piece of garbage here in New York City when Jesus came and found me and Satan would not let go. But Jesus, who has all power, looking in the eye, he cast a ray of light in his direction and neutralized his power over me. And I have been free ever since. Brethren, I understand the battle for the soul of men, because my soul was in danger. My soul was captive by the evil one, was held captive by the evil one. He was determined to kill me. But for the love and the grace of God, who had wove me in my mother's womb, who understood the plans he had for me to prosper, to be in good health, to preach his gospel, to let people know that he was coming again. But God allowed Satan to touch me so I could develop an experience and a testimony that I could use to present him to the world. This man is there, a poor, pathetic, dirty soul, useless to mankind, determined by the devil to be killed, to be tortured and killed. But Jesus decided it was his. Oh, the value God has placed on you. Oh, the value God has placed on me. Oh, the value we need to place on each other if we are going to be like our Heavenly Father. Brethren, I need you to get this. Unfortunately, the enemy of our souls continues to pervade the Christian church. He continues to impact the lives of those of us who call ourselves Christians. Yes, God understands that we all will stumble and fall. The Bible makes that abundantly clear. It says, for the just man will fall 7 times and get up. The key is to get up. And when you see your brother or sister fall, it is not for us to go from person to person talking about them, accusing them, condemning them, and maligning them. That's not God's way. We are to help them. We are to assist them so that tomorrow, if and when we fall, they will be there to help us up. Because the Bible says we are our brothers and sisters' keeper. Don't be like Cain and answer God when he asks you for your brother, when he asks you for your sister, am I my brother's keeper? The answer is yes. Jesus set the example. Earthly pleasures vainly call me, but I want to be like Jesus. So I read the Bible, I study his life, I look at the example he set, I see what he did for the worst of us, and I do the same to those around me. The Bible talks about the parable of the lost sheep and the lost coin. It also talks about the lost son. We're not going to go to the lost son. We're just going to focus on the lost sheep and the lost coin. Luke chapter 15, 1 to 7 and 8 to 10. Luke chapter 15. Brethren, I thank God for putting this spirit, this word on my heart last night and this morning, because it ministered to my heart. It ministered to my heart first. So I give God thanks and praise for his love towards me, say Lord, undeserving though I am, because he has delivered me from the pits of hell so that I can look at his son's example and emulate it, so that I can be an example like Jesus is. So, here goes. We go to Luke chapter 15. Luke chapter 15. And the Bible says in Luke chapter 15, and we read from verse 1, then drew nigh unto him all the publicans and the sinners for to hear him. And the Pharisees and the scribes murmured, the church leaders, the pious ones, the holy ones, in inverted commas. All right? They murmured, saying, this man receiveth sinners and eateth with them. And he spake this parable unto them, saying, what man of you, having 100 sheep, if he lose one of them, doth not leave the 99 in the wilderness and go after that which is lost until he find it? And when he hath found it, he layeth it on his shoulder, rejoicing, rejoicing, rejoicing. Brethren, when people give their hearts to Jesus, when lives are changed, we are supposed to rejoice, not get upset, not be filled with indignation. If somebody has changed, has been changed by Jesus, and we are not happy, we need to check the spirit that's possessing us. And when he cometh home, verse 6, he calleth together his friends and neighbors, saying unto them, rejoice with me, for I have found my sheep which was lost. I say unto you that likewise joy shall be in heaven. Where? In heaven. Over one sinner. How many? One sinner that repenteth more than over 99 just persons which need no repentance. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Look at verse 8. Either what woman having 10 pieces of silver, if she lose one piece, doth not light a candle and sweep the house and seek diligently till she find it? And when she hath found it, she calleth her friends and her neighbors together, saying, rejoice with me, for I have found the peace which I had lost. Likewise, I say unto you, there is joy in the presence of the angels of God over one sinner that repenteth. He repeats himself. The parable of the lost sheep is very applicable to the great work of man's redemption. The lost sheep represents the sinner that has departed from God. He or she is exposed to certain ruin if not brought back to Christ. All right? When we walk away, when we are out there lost, we are in the wilds, we are exposed to the wolves, we are exposed to the lions, we are exposed to the elements, we are exposed to all kinds of stuff. So there is a certain ruin that will occur to us if we are not brought back to Christ. Yet, he is not desirous to return. We out there and boy, our lives in danger, but we're not trying to get back. How many people you know trying to go to church and find Christ, as opposed to how many people you know want to go to the beach today, want to go to the club tonight, want to go to the ball game, who want to go and have fun? You know, we are lost and not aware of the danger of our state of lostness. We are unaware, we are oblivious, so we don't want to return. Christ, however, in earnest and determined fashion, comes to us to save us and to bring us back. He is determined and he is earnest. He leaves the portals of heaven. He comes to his fallen world and he goes about finding his lost sheep. one by one by one by one. He has 100 worlds populated with people who never sin. But he leaves them there and he comes down to this one earth that has fallen, that is in bondage, held hostage by the evil one, and he begins to work from within. He comes. He does not stand afar off and execute a war. He comes into the earth, makes himself subject to the prince of this world and the attacks and the effects of his attacks, so he can save you and he can save me. This story contrasts the love of God with the exclusiveness and the condemnation of church people. This story, the scribes and the Pharisees are murmuring and complaining because Christ is hanging out with publicans and sinners. Today, we see the same thing happening. When a brother stumbles and falls, there are people who jump on that and decide they're going to make sure he never rises again. That's not the spirit of God. That's the spirit of the Antichrist. But there are people, praise God, who got the spirit of God in them, and they will reach out in love. So we've got to understand the contrast of this story and line up on the right side. Verse 8 to 10 refers to a lost coin. A sheep will know it's lost because there's no other sheep around it. A coin does not know it's lost. It is lost in the house. That's significant, but does not know it is lost. This corresponds to church people who are pious and religious, yet full of condemnation, accusation, and indignation towards others. They're in church and they're lost because all they spew is condemnation. All they do is accuse. And when you see them, their attitude is one of indignation. They think they're better than you. They don't want to associate with you because they know they are better than you. Brethren, that is a lost coin. He's lost in church and don't know he's lost. Oh my goodness. Y'all think Satan easy? You think Satan playing? Have mercy on us, Heavenly Father. Have mercy on us. Jesus came to seek and to save that which was lost. If he is in me, then my commission is to go out and preach the gospel to every nation, kindred, tongue, and people. We have got to let people who are lost know that Jesus is mighty to save. Luke chapter 19. Luke chapter 19. And we're going to read from verse 1. And Jesus entered and passed through Jericho. And behold, there was a man named Zacchaeus, which was a chief among the publicans, and he was rich. And he sought to see Jesus, who he was, and could not for the press, because he was small in stature. He was short. And he ran before and climbed into a sycamore tree to see him, for he was to pass that way. And when Jesus came to the place, he looked up and saw him and said unto him, Zacchaeus, make haste and come down, for today I must abide in thy house. That's a statement of deliverance. When Jesus said to me, Silburn, put on the crack pipe. Silburn, stop the lying. Silburn, stop the stealing. Silburn, stop the gossiping. Silburn, stop allowing the other person that did not create you to control you. I am coming to take up residence. I am coming to your temple, your house today. Make haste. And Jesus is saying, For today, I must abide. To abide means to reside. It means to stay, to occupy permanently. And he made haste and came down and received him joyfully. The same way the man among the tombs made haste to Jesus. We see Zacchaeus making haste. Brethren, if we understand our condition, and if we comprehend and believe who Jesus is, we will make haste and come to him. Praise God. Verse 7. I just had a moment there. I just had a moment. Oh, Heavenly Father, be with us. Give us the strength. Ah, some days it's not as easy as it appears. And this body of sin, it can attack when one least expects. So in the name of Jesus, I pray that God will come nigh right now and help me to continue to present his word. Sometimes the devil will attack you in your mind. He will whisper things to you, accusatory. He will remind you of your past so that you will feel less than right to do what God has called you to do. I just had a moment. But in the name of Jesus, I say, get thee behind me, Satan. I may have been a bad guy. I may still stumble and fall today, but I don't belong to you. I changed my allegiance 19 years ago, and I stand on that decision. I will never look back. I will never willingly serve you again. I have found my maker. I have found my king. I have found the one who loves me with an everlasting love, and he has held on to me, and I don't want him to let go. Because if I hold on, I may lose my grip. But when God holds on, he holds on forever. And I thank him for holding me in his hand, in his powerful right hand, even now, so I can continue to preach his word. Luke chapter 19, verse 8. And Zacchaeus stood and said unto the Lord, behold, the Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor. And I have taken anything, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore to him fourfold. And Jesus said unto him, this day, salvation come to this house, for as much as he also is a son of Abraham. For the Son of Man is come to seek and to save that which was lost. The man among the tombs was lost. Zacchaeus, the rich, was lost. Don't think because you're rich, you're good to go. You understand me? And Jesus came to get the vagrant in the tombs and the rich man who climbed the tree. He wanted to possess their house. He wanted salvation to come to their house that day. And in both cases, it occurred. What prevents Christ from taking up residence in my house today? What prevents Christ from taking up residence in your house today? Choose ye this day whom you shall serve. Don't allow anybody to cause you to go to hell. The Bible tells us that God, the holy angels, all of heaven, rejoices.
verses. When one sinner repents, there was joy in heaven when that man was delivered at that beachfront. There was joy in heaven when Zacchaeus came down so Christ could possess his house. There was rejoicing in heaven. Brethren, while heaven rejoiced, the church leaders were murmuring. While heaven rejoiced, the church leaders were accusing. Listen, understand whose you are and which side you're supposed to be on. There can be no accusation and condemnation with Christ. That's an attitude of self-righteous, egotistical church people whose arrogance render them spiritually blind to their own sin and iniquity. They feel no need to repent. When people are condemning, when people are pointing the finger of accusation, when people are indignant towards people because they stumble and fall, these are people who are exhibiting an attitude of self-righteousness, egotistical, an egotistical attitude, and they are church people. They are the modern day scribes and Pharisees and sad UCEs. Because you know what? They're sad. You see? They are. And their arrogance has rendered them spiritually blind to their own sin and their own iniquity. They're so busy watching yours. They're so busy taping yours. They're so busy sending yours all over the place that they can't see theirs. Brethren, Jesus is real. Let us take stock in our lives. The only person I can save is me. So let God search me. There's a lot of people find it difficult to really take a good long look at the man in the mirror because they don't like what they see. So it's easier for them to look at someone else and articulate their sins. And if they can't find enough sins, they will make up some. But God loves you, and He loves me. And we have got to come back to a place where we love each other. I don't care what anybody did to me. I love you. And I will continue to love you. And I will pray for you day and night. Every chance God puts your name, every time God puts your name in my head, I'm praying for you. Because anybody going to make me go to hell. I'm going to pray. John 3:16 and 17 tells us something we need to take a closer look at. Jesus came to save us all by loving us, not condemning us. For God so loved the world, not the earth, the people that occupy the earth, that He gave His only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God sent not His Son into the world to condemn the world. Jesus couldn't come condemning and expect to save at the same time. Those two attitudes cannot emanate from the same source. It's either you love people back to hell, or you condemn them to hell. And Jesus wanted no part of hell. And He wants no part of hell for you. And He wants no part of hell for me. So brethren, it behooves us to humble ourselves and understand that I've got to take an introspective look at Silburn. And Silburn alone. If you're looking at Silburn, you may help me recognize something bad I'm doing. But it ain't doing nothing for you. You've got to do the same thing Silburn does. Take an introspective view of yourself. Ask God to search me. Oh God, know my heart. Try me. Put me in situations that will expose the real me. And show my heart. And see if there be any wicked way in me and lead me into thy ways everlasting. It is personal. It is personal. Salvation is personal. Remember that. It is personal, brethren. It is personal. All right? He didn't come to condemn. He came to save. And when we understand that, it can bring about a change in our attitude. In the book of 1 Peter, chapter 4. 1 Peter, chapter 4. And we read from verse 7 to 11. 1 Peter, chapter 4. From verse 7. But the end of all things is at hand. Be ye therefore sober and watch unto prayer. Reverend Peter is saying, Jesus is coming soon. The end of the world, all things, is at hand. So we need to be sober. We can't be drunk with anger. We can't be drunk with hatred. We can't be drunk with indignation. We can't be drunk with condemnation. We've got to be sober. May the Spirit of God possess us and sober us up and help us to be like Jesus. All right? So that we can begin to watch and pray. And above all things, verse 8, have fervent love among yourselves. I've got to love you. I don't care what you do me. I will continue to love you. God wants me to love my brother. He wants me to love my sister. It doesn't matter what my brother or my sister has done to me. It doesn't matter what my brother or my sister has said about me. I've got to love them. I've got to love them. Because I ain't going to hell for nobody. Jesus came to save me. And he told me, I've got to love. For love shall cover a multitude of sins. Jesus wants to cover your sin. Jesus does not expose our sins. Jesus does not expose. He covers. When the man in the tombs came to Jesus, he was naked. When Jesus took him to the water, he washed him off, or he baptized him. And then he took off his outer garment and he clothed him. He covered him up. He covered him up. Satan wants to expose you. He wants to make you naked. Jesus wants to clothe you. He wants to put you in his righteousness so you can be covered, so you can be clothed. When Adam and Eve sinned, they were naked. Satan exposed them. Ah, boy. When the woman with caught in adultery was brought to Jesus, she was naked. Satan had exposed her. When the seven sons of Sceva decided they were going to cast out some demons and they weren't prepared for that, the Bible says the demons grabbed onto them, beat them, and stripped them naked. Satan always strips us naked. He always exposes us. The Bible tells me in Revelation chapter 3 that the church in its present day state is naked. Satan has exposed the Christian church. Christ wants to clothe us. Is love covers what has been exposed. It covers a multitude of sins. And he has covered my sins. And he has covered your sins. And he has cast them into the depths of the sea to be remembered no more. The imminent return of Jesus should influence the believer's attitudes, actions, and relationships. I'm going to repeat that. The imminent return of Jesus Christ must influence the believer's attitudes, actions, and relationships. 1 Peter chapter 3, 11 to 15 says, let him eschew evil. The believer today must eschew evil. All right? Or depart from evil. Run away from evil. Abhor evil. Okay? And do good. Let him seek peace and ensue it. That's what we are supposed to be doing in these last days. For the eyes of the Lord are over the righteous, and his ears are open to their prayers.
But the face of the Lord is against them that do evil. And who is he that will harm you? If you be followers of that which is good, who will Satan send to attempt to harm you when you are held by God in the palm of his hands? But if you suffer for righteousness' sake, happy are you, and be not afraid of their terror, neither be troubled. But sanctify the Lord in your hearts, and be ready always to give an answer to every man that asketh you a reason for the hope that is in you, with meekness and fear. An exhortation to the readers to make an inner commitment to Christ. This is an exhortation to each of you within the sound of my voice, to make an inner commitment to Christ. Then we need not be speechless when called upon to defend our faith. Instead, there will be readiness to answer with meekness and fear. This means the Christian is always to be a gentleman or a lady, even when opposed by unbelievers. Our attitude towards people who come at us hard and dirty and want to destroy us must be that of meekness and fear, a gentlemanly or a ladylike response. We must be ready to stand gently before those that come at us in a bad and rough way. Our unapologetic defense of our hope in Jesus Christ is always to be given with love and never in degrading terms. Brethren, miserable, have fallen short where that is concerned. Sometimes when I get beat down by people I care about, people I love, people I trust, when people say all manner of things about me, some of it true, a lot of it not true, I get vexed, and sometimes I don't respond like that. And if I've done that to you and you are listening to this, I want to say sorry. Forgive me. I was not behaving after the similitude of my Heavenly Father. But I don't want to go to hell for nobody. So I stand here today to say, have mercy on me, Lord, for my past failings. Even as a minister, have mercy on me. And to those that I offended, please, Lord, may I make amends in any and every way possible, so that we can all make it to glory. I don't want to go to hell for nobody. And I don't want you to go to hell for nobody either. I don't want you to go to hell for me. Don't hold me in your heart till Jesus comes and bust hell wide open. Don't do that. I ain't worth it. You should not want to go to hell for nobody. Love forgives again and again and again. It covers. It does not expose. Only the evil one exposes sin. See John 8, 3 to 5. John chapter 8, verse 3 to 5. And it says here, and the scribes and the Pharisees, the church people, brought unto him a woman taken in adultery, and when they had set her in the middle, they said unto him, Master, this woman was taken in adultery in the very act, the pointing finger. Now Moses in the law commanded us that such should be stoned. What say you? Accusing a woman that they had been having sex with the night before. They were as guilty as she was. They were as guilty as she was. But they exposed her because the devil was in them. But Jesus expressed love. And he says to her in verse 9 of John chapter 8, verse 10 really. Woman, where are thine accusers? And she says, He says, hath no man condemned thee? And she says, no. Verse 11, Lord, no man. And Jesus says, neither do I condemn thee. But go and sin no more. I thank God for not condemning me and telling me to go and sin no more. My attitude, my behavior must change. There must be a conversion. There must be repentance. There must be acknowledgement of my sin and seek forgiveness for it. That's what is required. It was the devil in those church leaders that exposed the woman caught in adultery. It was their lack of compassion and love for a fellow sinner that drove them to this unfortunate act. They had the Old Testament scriptures. They read and taught them daily, but could not apply them. Because in Isaiah 53, verse 6, Isaiah 53, verse 6, the Bible says, all we, how many of us? Everybody, like sheep, have gone astray. We have turned everyone to his or her own way. And the Lord hath laid on him, Jesus, the iniquity and the sins of all of us. So what gives me the right to condemn you? What gives you the right to condemn me? What gives anybody the right to condemn anybody else when the sinless one never, ever condemned a soul? Not even Judas. There is nothing more dim-witted, empty-headed, and gullible than sheep doing their own thing and going their own way. How easy and quick are we humans to lust after manipulative false teachers and follow the deceptive doctrines of devils. How easily we simply stray from the path of truth and unwittingly wander into the way of ruthless wolves in sheep clothing, or foolishly fall into manifold dangers that litter our path. No wonder the term sheeple has been universally adopted to describe such gullible creatures as we are. Did you just get what I read? I'm going to read it again. There is nothing more dim-witted, empty-headed, and gullible than sheep doing their own thing and going their own way. How easy and quick are we to lust after manipulative false teachers and follow the deceptive doctrines of devils? How easily we simply stray from the path of truth and unwittingly wander into the way of ruthless wolves in sheep clothing. And you know why? Because we're not studying, so we don't know the difference between a sheep and a goat. You understand me? We cannot tell their fruit because we don't have the word of God to give us the information. We're not studying. All right? Or how we foolishly fall into manifold dangers that litter our path. No wonder the term sheeple has been universally adopted to describe such gullible creatures as we are. I ain't going to hell for nobody. You? What gives one sinner the right to point the finger of accusation at another sinner? Who gave us the right to condemn each other? John 8:11 and John 3:17 tells us it is not Jesus. Jesus says in John 8:11, neither do I condemn thee. John tells us in John 3:17 that God sent not his son into the world to condemn the world. So we know that when I condemn you or you condemn me, it is not Christ in me. It's the other power. You understand me? So it is the other power, the lower one, that inflicts us with self-righteousness and has his children, the self-righteous ones, accuse, condemn, and denigrate. How should we respond? Because the one that Satan is using, God loves. He died for that person. And we are brother and sister. We are all God's children. So we don't respond in kind. We are to respond like Jesus did. Turn with me to Galatians chapter 6. Galatians chapter 6. We're going to read from 1, 2, and 3. We bring it to a close here now, brethren, in a few. All right? Galatians chapter 3. Yes, after 10, we'll be done. We'll be done, hopefully, before 10:30 today. Galatians chapter 3. All right. I seem to be having a problem finding Galatians. It's right here. Galatians chapter 3. And we are going to, Galatians chapter 6, sorry. Galatians chapter 6. My bad. 1, 2, and 3. Brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such a one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. Bear ye one another's burdens, and so fulfill the law of God. Bear ye. I am supposed to bear your burdens. So you come at me bad. I realize you're hurting. Whether I am the cause of your hurt or not, it is my responsibility to humble myself, get meek, and begin to do whatever is necessary to make you feel better. Brethren, that's who I want to be to each and every one of you. That's who God requires me to be. And I say to him today, fill me with your spirit, because that kind of forgiveness can only be done through the power of his spirit. Philippians chapter 2, verse 5. How must we respond? How must we respond? Philippians chapter 2, 1 to 5. If there be therefore any consolation in Christ, if any comfort of love, if any fellowship of the Spirit, if any bowels of mercy, fulfill ye my joy, that ye be like-minded, having the same love Jesus exhibited, being of one accord, of one mind. Let nothing be done through strife or vainglory. I am going to go and talk about you to somebody else so I could look good. That's vainglory. I am going to put you down so I could look good up there. That's vainglory. Let nothing be done through strife and vainglory, but in lowliness of mind, let each esteem other better than themselves. Look not every man to his own things, but every man also to the things of others. Let this mind, brethren, be in us, which was also in Christ Jesus. It's the only way. Nobody go help us go to hell. We've got to develop the mind of Christ. Stop going to church every Saturday. Stop going to church every Sunday and continue to hold malice and hatred and envy. Ask God to take it away. Pray, 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 and ask God to take it away. No good thing that we pray for will God withhold from us. If we want freedom from malice, if we want freedom from hatred, if we want freedom from anger, we can ask God and he will take it away, so that we can be free to live and love victoriously in Christ Jesus. Okay? Luke chapter 6. Luke chapter 6. How must we respond when people come at us in a bad way? How must we respond? How must we respond? Luke chapter 6. And we are going to read from verse 27 to 36. But I say unto you, which hear, love your enemies, do good to them which hate you, bless them that curse you, and pray for them which despitefully use you. And unto him that smiteth thee on one cheek, offer also the other cheek. And to him that taketh away your cloak, forbid not to take your coat also. Give to every man that asketh of thee. And of him that taketh away thy goods, ask them not again. This is Bible, brethren. I'm reading the words of Jesus. Pay attention. Follow with me in your Bible as I read. And as you would that men should do to you, do you also unto them. For if you love them which love you, what thank have you? For sinners also love those that love them. But if you do good to them which do good to you, what thank have you? For sinners also do even the same. And if you lend to them to whom you hope to receive, what thank have ye? For sinners also lend to sinners to receive as much again. But love your enemies and do good and lend, hoping for nothing again. And your reward shall be great, and you shall be the children of the highest. For he is kind to the unthankful and to the evil. Be ye therefore merciful, as your Father in heaven is merciful unto you. That's how we respond, like Jesus did. Matthew 6:12 makes it abundantly clear. We are down to our last two scriptures, brethren, and we're going to shut it down. Matthew chapter 6, verse 12 tells us, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And forgive us our debts, all right? As we forgive our debtors. Lord, forgive me of my sins as I forgive those who have sinned against me. You know why? Because I've sinned against a whole bunch of people and I require forgiveness. So if I require forgiveness, I must be willing to give forgiveness. We are going to end on this parable. Matthew chapter 18. Matthew chapter 18. Look at verse 21 to 35. Matthew chapter 18. And the Bible says, then came Peter to him and said, Lord, how often shall my brother sin against me and I forgive him? Till seven times? Jesus said unto him, I say not unto thee till seven times, but until 70 times seven. Therefore is the kingdom of heaven likened unto a certain king, which would take account of his servants. And when he had begun to reckon, one was brought unto him which owed him 10,000 talents. But for as much as he had not to pay, the Lord commanded him to be sold, and his wife and his children and all that he had, and payment be made. The servant therefore fell down, and he worshipped him, saying, Lord, have patience with me. I will repay thee all. Then the Lord of that servant was moved with compassion. Somebody say, compassion. And loosed him and forgave him the debt. But the same servant went out and found one of his fellow servants which owed him 100 pence. And he laid hands on him and took him by the throat, saying, pay me that thou owest me. And his fellow servant fell down at his feet and besought him, saying, have patience with me, I will repay thee. And he would not, but went and cast him into prison till he should pay the debt. That's one sinner condemning another sinner for sinning. That's one sinner condemning another sinner for sinning. Brethren, we've got to stop doing that to each other. Because when I do it to you, I'm making sure I go to hell. When you do it to me, you making sure you go to hell. I ain't going to hell for nobody. You're not supposed to go to hell for nobody. The Bible says the master forgave him. He goes out and he does not forgive his fellow servant. And the Bible says, then the Lord, verse 32, after he had called him, said unto him, the wicked servant, I forgave thee all that debt because thou desirest me. Shouldest not thou also have compassion on thy fellow servant, even as I had pity on thee? In the same manner God hath pity on you, should you have pity on your fellow sinner? And the Lord was wroth and delivered him to the tormentors till he should pay all that was due unto him. So likewise shall my heavenly Father do unto us also, if we from our hearts forgive not every one of our brothers and sisters their trespasses. Brethren, I ain't going to hell for nobody. I ask you, if you are viewing this service today, and I have wronged you in any way, to forgive me. And even in a situation that is dire, you can call me. 347-675-8729. And let us make our wrongs right. I want to move forward doing God's work with a clear conscience and a pure heart. I want to move forward loving all my brothers and sisters in spite of what have happened between us. I want to move forward in peace and love and tranquility, putting you first. Jesus put me first. He's asked me to esteem you above myself. It's his word. And I take it seriously. And I want to live his word. His word must be hid in my heart. And his spirit must enable me through his power to live that word diligently, day after day after day after day. That is my desire. That is my hope. That is my prayer. Is it the same for you? If it is, just put your hand on your heart as I pray. Heavenly Father, may we all understand that forgiveness is a spiritual thing that can only be done through your spirit. We pray, Lord, that salvation come to our houses today, that your spirit pick up residence permanently in our body temples, and that he begins to change our hearts and our lives so that we may begin to forgive each other. We may begin to love each other. We may begin to treat each other in meekness and love. That we will begin to esteem each other better than ourselves. That we will support each other in every way. And that we will love each other with the agape love of God. Bless each and every one of us, Lord. Keep us from falling as we embark on a new week. Bless us and take us through this week safely. Protect us from harm and from danger. Provide for us. Keep us from lack. Keep us from sickness and sudden death. And may we be your witnesses this week like we have never witnessed before. And may somebody come to know and accept you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen and amen. I want to thank you all for joining us this morning in our service. I pray that God will grant you all the blessings of that are stored up in his storehouse for you starting this week. And brethren, let us ensure that when the roll is called up yonder, we'll be there. Let us ask God to enable us by His Spirit to be there when the road is called up yonder.
When the trumpet of the Lord shall sound,
and time shall be no,
and the morning breaks eternal bright and fair, when the saved of earth shall gather over on the other shore, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder,
when the roll is called up yonder,
when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there. On that riding cloud this morning, when the dead in Christ shall rise, and the glory of His resurrection share, when His chosen ones shall gather to their home beyond the skies, and the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
When the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder,
when the roll is called up yonder, when the roll is called up yonder, I'll be there.
Let us labor for the Master from the dawn to setting sun. Let us talk of all His wonders, love and care. Then when all the battle is over and our work on earth is done, and the road is called up yonder, I'll be there.
I'll be there. I want to say thank you to Sister Anne-Marie Florenville, Sister Brenda Samuel, Sister Patsy Bernard, Sister Florence Eugene Williams, Sister Thea Charles, Sister Camelia Arthur, Sister Arlene Jack, Sister Ann James in Grenada, Sister Hermina Miro down there in Maryland. God bless you. Brother Vernon Nicholas down there in St. Lucia. My brother, thanks for joining us. Sister Judith Stanislaus, thanks for joining us, sister. Brother Ron Granger and family down there in Atlanta, Georgia. Sister Lucy Terrence. Blessings, sister. Really nice seeing you on Thursday. Blessings. Sister Maggie Agdoma. Sister Christine Doxery and her husband Lucius. Thanks for joining us, brothers and sisters. Sister Vanessa Dola. Brother Victor Gordon, my brother. Thanks for joining us this morning. Sister Lyra Reed from down there in Texas. Brother Stephen Reynolds. Brother Keith Hazelwood, Brother Martin Blass, Pastor Keith Charles, thanks for joining us, brethren. Thanks for joining us. To God be the glory. Great things He has done. I hope this song will play to the end. Let us go forward this week, remembering what Jesus did for us. We were out there lost, but He came and got us and brought us home. There were 90 at 9. Sorry, that That's what we want to play. May God bless you. May God keep you. May His face continually shine upon you. And may He give you peace.
The shepherd made answer, this sheep of mine has wandered far from me. And although the hills may be rough and steep, I go to the desert to find my sheep. I go to the desert to find my sheep.
Sister Norma Long and Sister Cecilia Louiso and Brother Irvin, blessings.
Praise.